Today, I'm going to be talking about perception's ability to make miracles happen within just laughable, ridiculous time frames, thanks to the efficiency and ease of use of Cinema 4D. My name's John Lepore. I'm the Associate Creative Director at Perception NYC. We're a studio in New York. We do all sorts of fun motion graphics. You know, essentially, I guess we call it design-driven animation is our main thing. We use Cinema 4D as our main 3D app of choice. You know, we find it basically just works the best in our pipeline with the kind of projects that we generally deal with on a day-to-day basis. We work on all sorts of different kind of stuff. We do commercials, film titles, broadcast work, music videos, web content, you know. As long as there's some sort of interesting opportunity for some cool creative, we're happy to be a part of the project. I'm going to show you guys our general reel just to give you a better idea of what kind of stuff we're putting together in New York. Okay, so I should mention that is our general reel. That's not a reel that we put together just because we were going to be playing it here in the Maxon booth and gathered together all of our Cinema 4D projects. That's our reel that you'll see if you go onto our website. It just so happens that basically 90% of the content on there had Cinema 4D, you know, playing a really heavy role in those projects. We found that at our studio, our team, you know, consists of mostly generalists, and I wouldn't consider any of us to be hardcore 3D experts, but we end up being able to really kind of abuse our limited knowledge of the software and still get really fantastic looking stuff coming out of it on all of our projects. Most of our guys started out as really great After Effects animators that started to realize that they kind of need to have 3D, you know, a 3D tool in their arsenal, and found a really easy transition from After Effects into Cinema 4D, and especially because of the integration with After Effects, it makes it really easy to kind of start off with a really basic knowledge and, you know, work on a project that's, you know, mostly in After Effects with maybe one or two simple 3D elements, and then as you learn more and more, you start bringing more 3D elements in, and then you start learning how to export the camera data from Cinema into After Effects, and all of a sudden, you're doing everything in Cinema with just like a couple tweaks and a little touch-up in After Effects. You know, been really easy for everyone to get into it. We had a hardcore Maya guy come into our shop working with us, and he would start hitting roadblocks on certain things, and we would be like, oh, we can take care of that in Cinema. And we started showing him, some of the little tricks and the simple workarounds in Cinema 4D. And before we knew it, we didn't have a Maya guy anymore. We had a Cinema 4D guy. My bosses weren't too happy about that. They were really excited that we were diversifying, and now we're all back to Cinema. But it's what works best with our workflow. So, speaking of our workflow, I'm going to show you guys kind of how we involve Cinema in every step of our process. We usually start using Cinema right from the very start of the project. As soon as we get off the phone with the client, once we've been given the brief, we start jumping into Cinema to start making style frames or mood boards. Sometimes we'll jump right into making motion tests, little sample animations. And we find that, in the early stages of the project, that almost always is when the time frame is the tightest. And we find that Cinema just really lends itself to putting together nice looking stuff really quickly. From there, once we've kind of laid this groundwork in the pre-production stages of the project, that always ends up paying off when we get into production, Everything that we've been doing as far as putting the boards together and everything, all those assets are really easy to just carry right over into our final animation of the project. And we've already got scenes built, we already have environments or models existing, and we can just start setting some keyframes, and just makes it a lot easier for us to focus on more details because we've got so much of the foundation already built and already ready to go. So starting off, we almost always kick the project off with style frames. Making style frames tends to be one of our most favorite parts of the process. It's something that our team finds really exciting. There's often a lot of stuff at stake. Maybe we're pitching a new client that we've never worked with before. We know it's going to be a competitive pitch and we're going to be up against some other companies. And also there's always a ridiculously short time frame. They can never manage to find enough time for you to come up with the good ideas in the first place. It's always, we've got this, great project we want you to work on. Can we see some stuff tomorrow? And, that puts turns the pressure up on us a little bit, but we find all that pressure is generally, we just turn that into, we channel that into our creativity, and Cinema gives us all the tools that we need to do that and make it happen. And hopefully we can win our pitches and get some new jobs coming through. So let me show you something that we did. This was a set of style frames or a sort of mood board that we put together for the Independent Film Channel. IFC came to us and asked us if we could put together an opening sequence for a new show they had called Absolute Indies. It was a Absolute Vodka branded showcase of up-and-coming independent film directors. They came to us and they said, we just want to see an opening that kind of takes us back to the golden age of cinema. We want it to feel like it's the ideal environment and culture for a filmmaker to blossom and strut his stuff and still kind of, rather than focus on the cheesiness and the over-the-topness of Hollywood, kind of play up the glitz and the glamour of the old days, bring that magic back. So we wanted to put together a really rich, interesting, detailed environment. Now, in doing that, I personally am so far from being a 3D expert. I have a very limited knowledge when it comes to modeling and, really serious stuff. But I was still able to put together some really simple models, made this sort of daily planet globe, which is essentially, it's a sphere. I've got, some extruded text kind of wrapped around it, made a absolute bottle basically by just combining some spheres and cylinders. I mean, this is like super simple, like loser modeling here, really bland stuff. But in the end, I'm able to take this kind of stuff and start getting some really interesting looking renders out of it. Made our movie theater marquee, again, really simple stuff, basically a bunch of cubes, bunch of cylinders, really nothing special. I was very thoughtful about, even though this is just a bunch of cubes slapped together, pick one or two spots to get some nice details going on. made this sort of pseudo Art Deco shape in Illustrator, brought that right into Cinema, extruded it, and boom, we've got this nice detailed element around the window. And just having that, you know, in the context of everything else starts to make it feel a little more interesting, a little more realistic. Going in here to my entranceway here, I knew I wanted to have that big red carpet rolling out, but it can't just be a red square on the floor. I had to go in and make that one little, like, kind of bump in the carpet right there, and, you know, just to give it that extra little attitude. But again, you know, really simple stuff, very, you know, barely scraping the surface of what the software is capable of. And, you know, really simple models. Did some nice lighting and you know, got some nice textures on there. Started rendering out still frames and bringing those into Photoshop. Once I get this stuff into Photoshop, I like to just start kind of putting together my composition, starting to feel out, you know, where this whole thing's going to end up going. Let's see here. Turn on a couple other layers. And, you know, we start getting the whole kind of composition together by patching these pieces together. You know, this is important for something like this, which we consider a mood board. You know, we wanted to show one single frame that would give our client an idea of sort of the journey that we could take through this spot without having to show, you know, first we go from A, C to D to E to F. You know, we figured just kind of set the tone, get our composition right. You know, everything's looking pretty good here. We've got, you know, our nice models, a cool composition going on, but still there's something about it feels a little bit flat. So spend a couple hours in Photoshop just kind of playing with some lighting effects and whatnot, and we end up with something like this, which is, you know, already just looking a whole lot more detailed, a lot more, you know, textured, and it just gives it that extra oomph, that extra polish that kind of pushes it over the edge, you know. And again, this is all coming from, you know, a bunch of spheres and cylinders, just being, you know, just being thoughtful about where we want to put our time, where we want to put our emphasis on these elements. So let's see, another project we threw together some style frames for. This was something that our friends with the agency that handles Subway Restaurant, they had a Dance Dance Revolution promotion that they're doing. They were giving away DDR toys. I know you guys are all big fans of the Dance Dance Revolution game at the arcade, getting on there, stepping on the different aero pads and all that stuff. They came to us and asked us if we could put together some style frames. We got the call at about 6 o'clock at night when everyone's putting on their coats and getting ready to get into the elevator and head home for the night. And they call us up at 6 and say, you know, we want to get this project together. We'd love for you guys to be able to work on it, but we've got some other people that are going to be pitching some stuff. And here's the kicker. We need ideas ready to go to show to the Subway people first thing in the morning. So we're all kind of saying, all right, this is a little ridiculous. You know, we've basically got a handful of hours to get something together for this client. We jumped right into Cinema, knew we could pretty quickly turn something around that felt detailed, that felt interesting, you know, and kind of set the mood for what we're going with. So jumped in here, really quickly built like our sort of little pseudo stage element here, made our trademark Dance Dance Revolution arrow shape in Adobe Illustrator, brought that into Cinema, extruded it. And then we used one of Cinema 4D's MoGraph tools. We grab this cloner object. We take our arrow shape, we put it into the cloner, and then we can just say, all right, start making copies of this arrow. Now, not only can I start making copies and I can adjust how many of these arrows that I want to have here, but I could also go in and say that, you know, each arrow as we go along is going to be at a 45-degree angle, you know, or 45 degrees turned more than the previous arrow. So I can really quickly get this kind of uniform, all the arrows pointing in a different position. And from there, if you saw the previous frame, we wanted to have them kind of spiraling down from the sky and then intersecting with that Dance Dance Revolution dance pad on the floor there. So brought in a helix spline, which I can just pull right out of the spline primitive menu right here. Drop that into the scene, and you can see that guy right here. bringing that in, I've got all these controls to really quickly adjust its radius, how many times it's going to be twisting on itself, how high it goes, all of this stuff. So I get my helix set in there, got it kind of placed where I want it to be, and then I tell our aero cloner to reference this spline wrap tool, which tells it, take that helix spline and just wrap these arrows right around that spline. So now I've got these arrows kind of twirling around. It's like a much more interesting composition now. I can turn on our quick little dancing figure silhouette. And, you know, from there, we're really quickly, really easily able to get together this style frame, you know, spend a little bit of time in Photoshop adding some extra lighting effects, some extra color overlays onto the whole thing, and we've got something really nice. Now, the great thing here was the client saw this. This was waiting for them in their email box the next morning. They said to us, all right, we had a bunch of other people pitching this project, and they, because we gave everyone the brief last night at 6 o'clock, everyone else had the time to put together some really thorough written descriptions of what they would do if they had time. Instead, we were able to put together something that showed exactly what the final product was going to look like. And, you know, you can see from here, once we had this going, for the final project, we essentially set some keyframes for our spline wrap so that our spline would, our arrows would kind of travel down the spline. We set a couple camera keyframes to get some nice, simple rotational movement and, you know, did a little compositing and the spot was done. I mean, it was ready to go from the 3 hours that it took us to put together these style frames. So, you know, jumping right into cinema always helps us out on the back end. Now I'm going to show you guys some style frames that we put together for Showtime. Showtime contacted us and asked us if we could make a kind of image spot for their tentpole show, which is Weeds. Show Weeds is about this main character, Nancy, who's a suburban mother, but also secretly kind of a drug dealer. And over the seasons of the show, she's been getting herself into all sorts of different kinds of trouble and got involved in organized crime and whatnot. And they said, we've got this idea. We want to see Nancy hanging out in some sort of spider web environment. We want it to be that she's gotten caught up in a tangle of her own lies and deceit and everything. So we thought, all right, that sounds pretty cool. You know, I think we could find a way to make that glamorous and beautiful, but still a little creepy and interesting. You know, and we knew we could have just started pulling reference imagery of spider webs and start doing something in After Effects, just kind of layering up photos. But we knew that if we could do it in cinema, if we could find a way to make our spider webs in cinema, then it would give us a lot of opportunities when we got into animation, when we got into having, you know, control over these elements. So again, being the you know, borderline 3D novice that I am, I have no idea where to start with making a spider web. So I jumped onto Cineversity.com, which is Maxon's official tutorial website that that they put out there. They've got thousands and thousands of video tutorials that you can dig up on just about any subject. I punched in spider web and I got literally just a list of different videos all giving completely different techniques for making a spider web in cinema. I quickly breezed through a couple of them. I don't think I'm not like a big manual guy. I can barely even handle watching a full tutorial in its entirety. And I kind of skimmed through a bunch of them, found the one that seemed like it was most on my kind of loser level of ability, and found this one that Kai Peterson put together on using the Atom Array tool in cinema to make a spider web. So in doing that, you know, I pretty quickly was able to get up and running with putting a spider web together. Now, I wanted to give myself an extra challenge kind of on top of doing just a spider web. I wanted to really incorporate some copy points into the spider web. Our client gave us these sort of subliminal messages that they wanted to see throughout the spot. And I figured I wanted to get those embedded into the web. I wanted to make them look like they were nicely integrated and not just be clunky 3D text hanging in the web, but to be sort of like woven into the tapestry of the web, to give it a much more organic and natural feel, make it feel as though, you know, the spider itself had made this text really, you know, is just part of its whole initial organic design. So to do that, extruded my text elements that I brought in from Illustrator, took a plane and set my type up so that it's kind of intersecting this plane element. And then I did a Boolean operation on it. What a Boolean operation does is it essentially works almost like a Pathfinder operation in Illustrator, where it you can use one piece of geometry to subtract from another one. So did that to cut a hole in this plane. And because I'm using pretty complex geometry of this type to cut through the very simple geometry of a plane, you end up getting all these new polygons coming out. So these polygons, you can start to see sort of where this is going to be going. Just these new polygons formed, it almost kind of has a little bit of like a spider web feel to it. Like it, you know, you can see these strands going off into the corners. And from here, I knew I just wanted to keep pushing this just a little bit further. Right now, it's still a little too precise, a little too calculated, doesn't really look natural and realistic. So I take my Boolean object and I turn that into an editable object. I'm going to go into this plane here and take the knife tool. If I go into point selection mode here, I'm going to grab the knife tool. And what the knife tool is going to allow me to do is anywhere where I draw a line intersecting any of these polygons, it's going to make new polygons there. So now I can start adding any new strands of web that I want to add to this piece. And in doing this, I realized that, you know, I'm sitting here, I got my tablet, and I can just start like hacking away at this thing. I mean, I'm not really even paying close attention to what I'm doing, but I'm getting, you know, more and more organic kind of results by just slashing like crazy. You know, I just sat here for about, 5 minutes just going nuts on this thing, not really caring where I'm going, taking a moment, then maybe being like, all right, you know, it'd be nice if there was one that just went from here to here, and then go right back to just slash it away at this thing. So now that I've slashed away at this thing, it's looking all butchered up and starting to look a little more complex and a little more organic, I can take this and drop it into the atom array object. What the atom array object is going to do, I can pull that guy right out from here, the atom array is going to take any polygon edges and turn those into actual geometry. So in doing that, I instantly have geometry that's starting to look like an actual spider web here. So this is a little rough. I'll show you one that I took a little more time with and was getting slightly more calculated with. So I've got this guy here. This is looking pretty good. This is essentially what I'm looking for in this piece. I've got my text nicely integrated into this web element. I want to make it feel just a little more organic, so I threw a quick spherified deformer on it, which just gives it that little extra bow, makes it feel like it's sagging a little bit, and I'm pretty much there. But then going back and looking at all these reference imagery that we had of spider webs, and we looked at a couple, you know, spider documentaries and seeing all this stuff, we realize that when you look at a spider web is so fine, it's so thin that you're not even seeing the web itself. You're seeing little droplets that collect along the web. And, we realized that was going to be a key part of the design of this. So we made a quick sphere through a nice kind of water droplet texture on it and then dropped that into a cloner object. We tell the cloner object that it's going to reference our spider web geometry and randomly propagate droplets all over that web. And once we do that, we end up with something like this, where you get all these droplets. You know, there's just thousands of them hanging all over this thing. And we're really getting, you know, we're really getting our look together. You know, this thing is really starting to come together. Now, having these tools and the flexibility that these cloner objects and everything have, it gives us all these opportunities to play around and just kind of, you know, art direct our spider web and say, you know what, I decided that having 2,593 droplets was like just the right number. But maybe someone thinks that's too heavy. I want to drop it down to 750 droplets, and then I want to go in and make the droplets all a little larger. And, you know, we can do that. We can play around. We can just start goofing around with all these settings until we find what feels just right. And, you know, eventually we'll end up getting there and get our final look together. So, of course, from there, we take our render. We rendered our still frame out of Cinema, brought that into Photoshop, and really quickly just did some simple compositing. We wanted to bring the main character, Nancy, into this frame. We've got her there. Then we spend just a little extra time doing some lighting effects, some extra like forced depth of field blurs and stuff, and we end up with this. And, you know, put this in front of our client. They're blown away by this. It's looking very detailed, very rich, and it's a perfect representation of what's, you know, really a very complex, organic, and hard to predict sort of form that is the spider web, you know. So cinema, you know, definitely played a huge role in this project and helped us out tremendously in getting this one together. All right, so moving ahead, when we once in a while we have a project come through where we decide that rather than just putting some style frames together, we want to do some form of motion test. We want to make something that's going to give our client an idea of what these what this project's going to look like when it's moving. You know, sometimes just seeing a still image, one single frame, isn't enough to really sell the idea. Sometimes it's really more about the way something moves than just the way that it looks. So we quite often will use cinema to throw together motion tests really quickly, and we find that, you know, we're able to pretty quickly and pretty efficiently get really nice looking renders coming right out of the program. This was something that we put together for a racing-based reality game show. We had a variety of different directions that we were presenting to this client for a competitive pitch. And we were about to head over to their office to present all of this stuff to them when they gave us a call and said, you know what, we can't meet you at 11 a.m. We got to push it back till 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So we were left with a couple extra hours on our hands. We really wanted to get this pitch, and we said, you know what, we got a couple hours. This might be ridiculous, but let's see if we can get some sort of motion test together. Just something, just so that we can show them something moving. If they see that, it almost always pushes them over the edge and makes sure that we win the job. So grabbed a couple car models, brought them in, threw a really simple shader. Rather than go for something that's very accurate and photorealistic, we figured this lent itself to a really nice stylized look with this super slick, extra shellacked car look, you know. And then we wanted to play around with this concept where you see these copy points in this text and it's sort of distorted along these cars. And if we showed them just a single frame that looked like this, they would be like, yeah, I don't get it. It looks kind of like there's some weird racing stripes on the car or something. But when you see it moving and you see that moment when it just comes together and it all of a sudden goes from being distorted and illegible to all of a sudden it just comes together, it makes sense, and it gives you this brief little kind of aha moment, you know, sells the idea. Couldn't have done this with just some frames, had to do the motion test for it. This was something that we put together for our friends at ESPN. They came to us and wanted us to make something for their full court DirecTV college basketball package. And this was a couple summers back. They were saying, hey, you know, we'd like something sleek, modern, you know, a little bit of a futuristic edge, but something that still screams sports. So we did this kind of robotic flipping screen element that, of course, has that kind of Jumbotron feel to it. Went into Illustrator and essentially just kind of thoughtfully made these individual shapes one by one, assuming, you know, how they would interlock with each other. Brought these into Cinema, extruded them, set some simple, you know, anchor points, a couple rotation keyframes, and we had this action coming together. Made a quick sort of scoreboard animation in After Effects, brought it in as a texture, threw the quick kind of pixel bump map on it to seal the deal, and we were set. The final product for this looked almost exactly like this motion test that we put together in the very first stages of the project. Electronic Arts came to us and asked us to put something together for their newest version of the Madden football game. They came to us and they said, we have no idea what we want, but we've got this great music track that we want to use. That was basically their brief. It was make it look cool and make it happen to this song that they included in the email as an MP3. So we took the song, fed that into a MoGraph sound effector, and was able to use the different levels in that song to actually actuate the animation and the action of this piece that we put together here. So you'll see all of a sudden the track comes in, and we've got our football field kind of turns into this live graphic equalizer that's just responding exactly to the MP3 that the client sent us. That was our first motion test. That was what got us the job. This is the final product. It's almost exactly the same thing, essentially. So again, you know, having jumping right into cinema at the very start of the project, you know, not only does it give us something much more convincing to put in front of our client, but it helps us out so much more on the back end when it comes to finally animating the piece. This is something that we did for our friends at HBO. They came to us, again, one of these very generic briefs, you know, just make it look cool, make it impactful. We want it to feel very energetic. I don't really know what's going on here. I don't know what this is supposed to represent, but it looks cool. It looks interesting. We've got this cool device of bringing our copy points on. Again, they're sort of distorted, but then there's that brief moment when it comes together and you can read your points, and you've got these very energetic blocks, you know, exploding outwards and then vacuuming back together and blasting back out again. Showed this to our client. They loved it. They were like, yeah, I don't know what this is, but it looks great. This is cool. Kept moving up the chain. Everybody was loving it. No one knew what it was. Then someone figured out what it was somewhere near the top of the chain. They were like, that's great. It looks just like cheese fries. Killed the project right there on the spot. You know, don't ever call anything cheese fries that you've worked on. Luckily, we had some backup concepts to run with and didn't have to push forward with something that everybody was thinking was a... you know, an Arby's cheese fry commercial of some sort. So, all right, getting past the motion test. When we get into our final animation process on any of these projects, you know, we find that we can still, you know, even though cinema's given us so much that we can do in a really tight time frame, when we've got a little more time to play with something, we can get into some of the more detailed aspects. We can spend a little more time polishing. You know, there's a lot of depth to the program that lets you just go so far with your animations and your renders and everything. And then sometimes on a final project, you still don't even have enough time to do anything. We had our friend Dennis Liu, a director that Microsoft sought out to put together a pseudo movie trailer campaign for the newest version of Microsoft Office. For Office 2010, they wanted to do this whole campaign all summer long where it was one kind of fake movie trailer after another, kind of selling Microsoft Office as a big budget, you know, blockbuster summer event film. So the director, you know, he's got this massive vision for putting this thing together. He's starting to shoot all this footage. He's getting, you know, he's renting helicopters. He's got motorcycle stunt drivers, you know, chasing each other on the FDR in Manhattan. He's got all this stuff coming together. But as he's just, you know, as he's getting production moving on this thing, Microsoft starts having some doubts and wondering why they got this young kid director to fly helicopters all around the city and blow stuff up and whatever. So he says, all right, guys, I need your help. You know, I got no money, I got no budget, and I have no time. They're about to pull the plug on the project, and I need to have some sort of teaser. I need something that sets the tone, something that lets them know that this thing is going to be awesome. It's going to be over the top. It's going to feel like a summer blockbuster. He says, you know, I need something immediately. Like, I need something in the next 48 hours to show to them. And we said, all right, we'll give you a hand. We'll do what we can. He had no footage shot yet, no assets, no material, still was working out his script. So he basically had nothing to work on, but had to, you know, with whatever materials that we could generate ourselves, put together a spot for him. So to get the thing rolling, we really quickly put together a simple frame just to kind of illustrate where we were going. We knew, you know, this was kind of a parody of the summer blockbuster sort of vibe. So we figured it was appropriate to kind of play up one of these usual devices that everyone's used to seeing. This is the Microsoft Office logo here. And we figure, all right, we spend the entire time of this sort of teaser with the camera flying through these sort of hallways, these almost corridors within the logo. And then at the end, the camera pulls out, looks down. You see you were inside the logo the whole time. We've all seen it a million times before, but seemed really appropriate for this kind of project. So jumped right into cinema, brought in our Microsoft Office logo, and started making all these different iterations of it. At first, we started with one version of the logo only, and started moving the camera around in there and realized that there wasn't, within this one logo, there actually wasn't enough room to take a bunch of interesting twists and turns without just going in a circle a couple times. So we took this logo, added a whole bunch of other ones in there, and started to kind of build up this landscape that, you know, from above looks something like this. Then we wanted to get our camera kind of running through and navigating through these hallways. So to do that, I actually made a spline just to sort of like mentally figure out where this camera is going to go and try to figure out a path so that it's not making, you know, four left turns in a row or anything. It keeps it interesting. Starts off with a little bit of a long runway to take up some speed, then starts turning around the corners, and then has another long runway where the camera is ultimately going to pull out of at the end. So at the end of the day, we ended up with something that looked essentially like this, where we're weaving through these corridors, pulling out, and boom, the logo's there. And you know, little bit of sort of a motion graphics cliche, but we're really embracing it. You know, this is a parody. This is something we're trying to have fun with, kind of poke a little fun at the big movies that are coming out this summer. So took that guy, spit that out into some renders, brought it into After Effects, did our final touches, and within 48 hours of starting the project, we essentially ended up with this teaser.
There are 5 billion working people in the world. In 2010, their hero will arrive. Office 2010, the movie, coming to an office near you.
So with no assets, you know, no script, no footage, we're able to throw together something that sets the tone and sets the stage. Dennis then went on, you know, got Microsoft's confidence. They actually put this up on their site as the teaser for the actual trailer. You know, Dennis finished up the trailer, looks amazing. It looks, you know, super high profile. And we're very happy to have been able to sort of open the door for that and set the stage for this big piece that he put together. I'm going to show you guys one last project real quick. I'm going to try and run through this one because I'm running out of time here. We put together a rebrand for the SNY Network and the New York Mets starting in the fall and you know, premiered on opening day. The Mets moved into a new stadium this year. They ditched crummy Shea Stadium for a brand new Citi Field. A little bit of an upgrade for them, and they wanted to upgrade their whole look. They wanted to make their on-air presence feel much more polished. Wanted to have, you know, a full package, in-game graphics, all the stats, all the lower thirds, all of that stuff, transitions, everything, you know, hundreds of elements delivered, a lot of elements that we created that were then set up and made in modular ways to work with their real-time VizRT guys who are sitting in the truck triggering these things on the fly during the game. And also put together a number of opening sequences, including one for the game itself. So real quick, I'm going to show you guys our montage of all of the elements that we put together for the Mets this year. So as we're going through this montage, you can see a couple glimpses of our main opening sequence. We take a look at Citi Field. We fly right into the new rotunda of Citi Field, and there's this gigantic baseball with these arrows running around it, which as they run around the arrow, you can see they're obviously representing the threads on the baseball. And this is an element that ran through the whole package. You know, it was kind of our common thread through the whole project. You know, tied the whole thing together. So I'll show you guys how we set up this one scene to have our threads winding around the baseball. So in putting this together, we had our kind of model of the this inner rotunda area set up, put our baseball in there, and we knew we wanted to have our arrow elements winding around the ball. So really quickly took the ball, figured out what these sort of lines are like, this pattern that actually makes the shape of the ball, set up some splines that actually ran right along those contours. And, you know, having those splines set up and good to go, you know, we were making all sorts of splines that look like this, very complex shapes, but just kind of going in and looking at the ball, studying it and figuring out how to get these forms to just hug right along the surface of the ball. Once we had that set up, took a while to get that spline perfect, but once we got that spline set up, we used that for our cloner, which is running these arrows around the ball. Told the cloner object, you know, make a gazillion clones of these arrows and then have it reference that spline for the path that it winds around. We also wanted to make all these sort of spotlights shooting out of where the holes would be for those threads to weave through the ball. So as the arrows run around, these spotlights burst on, once again, referencing that same spline that was, you know, really difficult to get together at first, but once we had it set, we had all these different elements that could reference that same element, and through a quick step effector on our spotlight cloner, and we're able to have our spotlights pop on one after another, kind of exploding out of the surface of the ball, choreographed just when we want them to, so that just as the camera's hugging that you know, curve of the horizon of the ball, those lights are blasting right out from underneath. So in putting that together, we ended up with our final sequence for the open, which ended up playing out like this. So that was how we got our new package together for the New York Mets for this season. Hope this is giving you guys a little insight as to how we use cinema in our workflow at Perception in New York. Please let me know if you have any questions at all about any of the stuff that you've seen up here. We've got some demo wizards sitting at the back of the booth. If you guys want to see some cool stuff happening in cinema in action, they can show you all sorts of cool tricks and shortcuts. And, you know, let any of us know if you have any questions at all. Thanks a lot for coming by, guys.